Good morning. Oh, thank you for your prayers. I have this much voice and I'm going to use it to preach. The last time I was in 1 John, we were talking about how to test spirits. Very, very important topic. And what we learned was that the Holy Spirit working through someone will always lead to the confession of Christ, the true doctrine of Christ, his preexistence, his virgin birth, his sinless life, his miracles, his substitutionary death on the cross, his bodily resurrection, his ascension into heaven, that he is fully human, fully God, he's coming again. Everything is true about Christ. The Holy Spirit will cause us to confess Christ. And when the doctrine of Christ is compromised, and when the gospel is not preached, I don't care how much talk, how much hype, how loud, how much jumping around, the Holy Spirit's not working. Because Christ isn't preached. Interestingly, as I've written articles and a couple books and have gone around in the past when I had better health, I traveled more preaching. And when I run into pastors, I always say the same thing. Preach Christ. And it's interesting, every once in a while you get a blank stare. You just know they're not going to do it. But today, having found that we need to preach Christ, I want to emphasize that some more because we are facing deception. Let me read the text. 1 John 4, 4 through 6. You are from God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is he who is in you than he who is in the world. And they are from the world, therefore they speak as from the world, and the world listens to them. We are from God. He who knows God listens to us. Now, I want to make a comment. Assuming we're preaching Christ. Okay. And he who is not from God does not listen to us. By this, we know the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. So let's go to the first part of verse 4. 1 John 4, 4a. I'm using the NASB. You are from God, little children, and have overcome them. Them, the false prophets, 1 John 4:1. The Antichrist spirit, already been discussed in 1 John. The world listens to people who do not preach Christ. The world listens to people who have a worldly message. And it's so important to us that we don't get intimidated. That is one of the big issues. And I remember when I first went to seminary in the 90s, the church growth movement was coming in, and I saw so many young people being trained for the ministry who were intimidated because the experts are saying, you know, if your church isn't growing and your church isn't big, you're doing something wrong. And you need to come up with a different plan. You need to learn something new or something different. But the fact is that we need to know what God has called us to do. We need to know what God has called us to preach. We need to know what God said that he would use to save the lost, to sanctify the saved, and to cause us great hope and confidence as we face the battles of life. The next time I preach, I will be preaching on the fact that the world hates us. And that hatred was predicted by Jesus Christ. So it'll be in a few weeks, but when I do preach again, it'll be from John 15. So we need to know that we're doing what God called us to do. To be from God includes valid faith, godly practice, and abiding commitment. Never, ever, if we're from God and preaching His word, do we need to decide to switch and go do something else. Don't be intimidated. Now, the word here for overcome in the Greek, the kao, means to defeat or to conquer. And so you could translate this various ways. You have conquered them. You have defeated them. And we're using here overcome because it's pretty common in a lot of English translations. And when we read in Revelation, and I have the verses there, and if you have the notes, you can see them. Overcomers are the ones who believe in Christ and are serving Him. And the whole world is opposed to us. The whole world hates those who love Christ. And so to overcome them is to not listen to their message. Everywhere you look, everywhere you hear, every time you turn on the TV, somebody is telling you that it's really bad that you're a Christian. Something's wrong with you because you believe the way you do. Something's wrong with you because the Bible tells you what's right and wrong. How dare you believe that? And so is the battle. I'll talk about that more next time I preach. So we believe and confess the truth about Christ. Now I want to say something here. Overcomers are not higher order Christians. Overcomers are all Christians who have been transferred from darkness to light, from the kingdom of Satan to the kingdom of His beloved Son. We have to get out of our mind this idea that we can be some superior Christian to ordinary ones. Because the only way to be a Christian at all is to be converted. And if the Holy Spirit has snatched you out of the kingdom of darkness and brought you to Christ, you're an overcomer. Don't be intimidated. Somebody's always going to say, you're not good enough. You're not a good enough Christian. We have the secret to the deeper life or whatever it is. We're not higher order. We believe and we trust. And this status, here it says, have overcome, perfect active indicative, began at conversion when we listened to the truth of the gospel and believed. All who abide in Christ are of God. So we won't listen to the message of the false teachers. Jesus comforted His apostles, and through them us, in John 16:33. These things I have spoken to you, so that in me you may have peace. In the world you have tribulation, but take courage. I have conquered the world. Go to the last part of that verse, as I get another cough drop. Eric and I know everything there is about cough drops. So if you need any counsel, we've got it for you. 1 John 4:4b, because greater is He who is in you than he who is in the world. Now, all believers, as Eric preached, are indwelt by the Holy Spirit. We are born of the Spirit. We are filled with the Spirit. And God is living in us because we know him. So the greater one in us is God, who indwells us by the Holy Spirit. We are born of God, as said earlier in 1 John 2:29. If you know that he is righteous, you know that everyone who practices righteousness is born of him. We would not even want to do this, to live for God, had we not been born from above. This is true for everyone who comes to Christ. I know this for a fact. When I came to Christ, I wanted to be different. Before I came to Christ, I was proud of the way I was and willing to tell anybody that that's the way it was. There's nothing wrong with me. There's just something wrong with everybody else, because I'm right because I'm me. But once I came to Christ, I knew that I was so wrong. I was so lost. I needed Christ. Victory over the world is through God working in those who truly confess. You can tell what motivates people because they speak according to whatever spirit motivates them. The world speaks according to the spirit that motivates the world, spirit of Antichrist. And that's why we can know who the true prophets are. And by the way, the Bible uses the term prophet in a couple different ways. One way is technical, somebody like Jeremiah or Ezekiel. And the other way is speaking forth the truth of God. Luther did a great job with this at the time of the Reformation. Whenever any believer preaches the gospel, you, dear saints, are prophesying. You can tell anyone the true way to God through Christ, and your words are just as powerful as the most silver-tongued preacher. And the term prophet is used places like 1 Corinthians 14 in a functional sense, the one who preaches the gospel. So don't be intimidated. You're somebody who can tell anyone the way to God. So there's no cosmic dualism I have here on my slide. Let me just make a quick comment on that. Dualism is the idea that good and evil are equal forces in the universe and are engaged in a perpetual battle with an uncertain outcome. So when I just wrote this article, and I talk about two-domain theology, I'm not teaching dualism. Why? Because God existed in all of his attributes before anything else was created. God in his perfection, in his holiness, in his love, and everything that's true about him, his omnipotence, was God perfectly before anything is created. Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Satan was the first rebel. Evil is not eternal because it came into existence through the rebellion of a created being. Evil will ultimately be conquered and thrown into hell, and so dualism is not true. God is more powerful, God is eternal, God is great, and God wins the battle every time. So we're not teaching that, but we are saying there are two spiritual domains, and by nature we were in the wrong one. We were in darkness and under Satan, even if we don't believe there is a Satan. Only God is all-powerful. Now, you've seen this slide before if you've been here before, but I put it up again because we've got to get this right. The term cosmos in the Greek New Testament is used in three different ways. And when we're talking about the world listens to the false prophets, we're talking about the world in its alienation and rebellion against God. But the term can be used to mean the universe, the created whole outside of God. The creation, the world, everything. The whole world. Or it can mean the abode of humanity. I'm calling this world two. The theater of history. The inhabited world. The place of human affairs. Now, dear saints, when we're converted, we stay in world two. I'm starting to read a book by some guy claiming we need to resurrect monasticism. No. And I'm going to write about it. The book is bugging me so much, I got to write a CAC article. No. We don't go get in a monastery to get away from the world. If you want to get away from the world, go to Christ. He'll save you right in the middle of it. The guy from the Gerizines, who was in the worst demonic shape anybody's been in, when Jesus delivered him, he said, go back and tell your people what God did for you. If he can be trusted to confess Christ, so can we. Now, world three is what we're talking about. The fallen creation, the setting of salvation history, the human world that is hostile to God. That's what we're saved out of. So we're in the world, the creation, the theater of human affairs, but we're saved out of the rebellion. It says in 1 John 2:17, the world is passing away and also its lusts, but the one who does the will of God lives forever. Now let's go to verse 5 of 1 John 4. They are from the world, therefore they speak. Therefore they speak as from the world, and the world listens to them. This is so important. Frankly, when I was in the seminary, and the church growth movement came in, and I started hearing these theories, I was thinking, what? This guy, Donald McGavran, invented the idea. And he said, people don't become Christian for theological reasons. They become Christians for sociological reasons. Therefore, now we got to spend all our time on sociology. What do people want? What are they looking for? What's important? Understand the culture. Try to get something that people will like. Because we've got to get the world to listen to us. So I know that one teacher, I bugged him so much, he actually was banging his head on the chalkboard. Because I kept disagreeing. No. They're from the world. They speak from the world listens to them. That shouldn't surprise us. That's the way it's always been. And we see that. I'll talk about it more the next time I preach. Turn on the various news channels. The newspaper, just pick it up. If anything even looks like it's Christian, they're immediately against it. We don't need to know anything more. Is that right? Oh, it's Christian. That's bad. It's evil. It's no good. We can't have that. So the world listens to them. So the world will listen to a false Christ. If you change the doctrine of Christ, if you have a Christ that's going to give everybody prosperity, if you have a Christ who's going to make you feel better about yourself, if you have a Christ who's going to give you self-esteem, if you have a Christ who's going to resolve whatever you see as your felt needs, well, then they may listen to that. But this is not optional for us, dear saints. We must preach the Christ of the Bible. Preach Christ. It says in 1 John 5:19, we know that we are from God. The whole world lies in the power of the evil one. The whole world. In its rebellion. It says in 2 Corinthians 4, 3 and 4. And even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing, in whose case the God of this world has blinded the minds of the unbelieving so that they might not see the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is in the image of God. How in the world can that be rectified? They're blinded by Satan. There's only one possible way that that will ever change. Jesus Christ said, "I am the light of the world. Whoever comes to him will never be in darkness." Only Christ, through his power, his redemption, by the power of the Holy Spirit, will ever resolve this problem. And if we want people to come alive, to exit the darkness, we will preach Christ. The sinful world doesn't want to hear that, but we have to preach it. First part of verse 6, 1 John 4, 6a. We are from God. He who knows God listens to us. He who is not from God does not listen to us. I was looking at this yesterday, and I wrote it quite a while ago, so I had to go back and go through my own sermon to see what I'm going to preach today. So I was thinking about something. When I was a new Christian, and I saw this verse here, it made me think of it. There was an old preacher that I heard, and I know he was sermonizing, and this isn't exactly what the prodigal son was about, but these old preachers had a good way with words. And here's what he said. If you put out the slop, the pigs will come. He was thinking about the prodigal wanting to eat with the pigs. If you put out the spiritual food, the sons and daughters will come. And he said to the young preachers, you need to preach the truth. Feed people pure spiritual food. The sons and daughters will grow in the grace and knowledge of God. God will feed us, change us. We don't have to have the biggest crowd, but we have to have the truth. And it needs to be pure and unadulterated. Jesus said in John 10:27, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. That's it. That's what we know. I love what Luther said about this at the Reformation. By the way, that doesn't mean I agree with everything Luther taught. I don't. But he did some good teaching, too. Here's what Luther said. Luther's Works, Volume 36. Quote, this fact, however, constrains us and makes us sure, namely, that a real Christian knows that the church never ordains or institutes anything apart from the Word of God. Luther says any church that does is no church except in name only. Church in name only. Wouldn't that be an interesting acronym? Are there any churches in name only? Oh, yes. Here's what Luther went on to say. Quote, it is not God's word because the church speaks it. Rather, the church comes into being because God's word is spoken. If we want the church to be the church that honors Jesus Christ, God's word and only God's word will be taught. And preached. Who are we reaching and who are we teaching? So that's how we know. By this we know the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. By this we know. Are you ready to write? I'm going to give you verses. 8 times. 8 times. 1 John 2, 3. First John 2:5. 1 John 2:18. 1 John 3:16. 1 John 3:24. 1 John 4:6, our verse. 1 John 4:13. 1 John 5:2. 8 times in the Greek we have, by this we know. Do you think that we can know the truth? John says 8 times, by this we know. He's telling us how we know. He gave us 8 different verses about it. We know the truth based on the gospel of Christ, based on what God has said, based on how we live, you know, in accordance with what Christ teaches. We stay on the path that God put us on. We abide in Christ. The word for heir, plane, when I put a little underline after the E, I'm trying to remind us that it's not epsilon, it's eta. So, plane, it means deceit, heir, wandering from the right way. The Greek, or one of the Greek versions of the Old Testament, uses the term in Jeremiah 23:16-17. Let me read that to you. Thus says the Lord of hosts, do not listen to the words of the prophets who are prophesying to you. They are leading you into futility. They speak a vision of their own imagination, not from the mouth of the Lord. They keep saying to those who despise me, the Lord has said, you will have peace. As for everyone who walks in the stubbornness of his own heart, they say, calamity will not come upon you. Stubbornness is plane, going off into air. You could almost say this. The false prophets always have the same message. What is it? Peace, peace. Peace, peace, when there is no peace. So now let's go back to our 2 categories. Denying or confessing. 1 John 2:23 denies the Son. 2:23b confesses the Son. 1 John 4:3 does not confess, is not from God. 1 John 4:2 confesses, is from God. 1 John 4:5, from the world. 1 John 4:6, from God. 1 John 4:5, the world listens to them. Yeah, they do. I wonder if some of these people like Joel Osteen have a big audience. Oh yeah, but what's his message? Your best life now. Guess what, saints? This isn't it. There's better to come. He who knows God listens. 1 John 4:6, spirit of error. 4:6, spirit of truth. Does not abide. Abides. You see, discernment is not as difficult as people think. We can discern. We don't have to be deceived. We can know we're right with God. We can have God's peace in our heart. We don't have to listen to the false prophets. We don't have to listen to the world. God will help us so we know the difference. And then, There's the spirit of Antichrist, the spirit of God. And if we preach Christ, that'll be a work of the Spirit of God. Two applications. Number one, we must preach God's word. Number two, the Holy Spirit will convict the world. Let's go to 2 Timothy 4:2. Let me tell you right up front, I have used red to highlight them. There are five imperatives. Do you know what an imperative is? It's a command from God in this kind of context. The author says, do this. This is important. Here's the five imperatives. Preach the word. Number one. Be ready. Number two. I'll talk about in season and out in a bit. Reprove. Rebuke. Exhort. With great patience and instruction. So preach the word is what God wants us to do. I want to make a commitment to you, dear flock. I do have physical limitations, and it's a battle. But I promise you this, whatever I've got that I can do, I will preach the word. And I will work hard, and I will make sure it's true, it's accurate, and that you can hear it and understand it. That I can do. And some days I might even do it without coughing. But nevertheless, the word will be preached. May God help us. That's by God's grace. Now, I can't claim I'm going to do anything other than by God's grace. But we all have to do this. This isn't just for some. This is what Paul told Timothy, but we need to take it to heart. Preach the word. If we're going to be ready, we've got to study in season and out. Interesting words. There's this word, eukairos, or ikaros, or akaros. Eukairos, ikaros. In season would be sort of a favorable time with a prefix U. Like Eusebia would be piety. So it's a good time. People want to hear it. But akairos would be an unfavorable time. So in season and out. So here's the deal. Paul says, don't worry about the season. Preach the word. But they don't want to hear it right now. It's not popular. Preach the word. They want to hear about health and wealth. Preach the word. They want to hear about social changes in the world. We're going to make the world Christian without Christ being here. No, preach the word. They want to hear about, no, preach the word. There's never a bad season for the word of God. I grew up on a farm. I know about seasons. And there's a season for harvesting. But when it comes to preaching the word, there's no season. It's always the right time. Reprove, rebuke, exhort are all ways of talking about using the word of God to change things that need to be changed. So we don't want to hear sound teaching. It doesn't matter. We've got to preach it anyhow. So that means that the truth must be proclaimed with urgency. You know, this is kind of strong. Made me think. Yesterday I was thinking about it. I heard another old preacher. Back in the 80s, there was this TV network that was real popular until a scandal sunk it. Remember that? And this old preacher was going to be on that network. And I heard him interviewed, and they said to him, well, if you're going to be on our TV channel, we got to tell you a few things if we're going to have you as a guest. And he said, well, what's that? They said, well, whatever you do, don't command. We don't want you to command people anything. He said, well, if I can't command, what do you want me to do? And they said, invite. If you're going to be on TV, you got to invite. And this old brother, Greenaway was his name. He said, when Moses went up on Sinai, God did not give him 10 invitations. You may not want me on the TV, but I'm not going to invite. I will proclaim. For the time will come when they will not endure sound teaching or sound doctrine, but wanting to have their ears tickled, they will accumulate for themselves teachers in accord with their own desires. They will turn away their ears from the truth and will turn aside to myths. Now, this seems counterintuitive. If they won't endure sound doctrine, doesn't that mean you have to give them something else? No, because they won't endure sound doctrine, reprove, rebuke, exhort. Okay, they don't want sound doctrine. So what do? You teach sound doctrine. What else is there to teach? God will take some people, get them out of the world of deception, out of the domain of Satan, out of the darkness. He will bring them into the light and change them. Sound doctrine must be preached in the church. The truth is also synonymous with the gospel. Have you believed in Jesus Christ? Have you turned to him? I told you who he is earlier, the eternal Son, the sinless one, the virgin-born Son of God. He ascended on high, and he's coming again. But we need to repent and believe the gospel. Today, nothing is more urgent. Repent and believe the gospel. Confess to Christ. I've sinned. I've failed. I'm in utter darkness. I can't solve any of my own problems. And my big problem with sin is hopeless. Dear Jesus, save me. Rescue me. Cleanse me. Forgive me. And bring me when you come to be with yourself in heaven. One more verse. This is about the Holy Spirit. It says in John 16:8, and he, when he comes, will convict the world concerning sin and righteousness and judgment. I was reading a commentary on this by D.A. Carson, and he had a fabulous way of understanding this that I think fits the context, and it sheds light on a difficult passage. Carson says that whenever this word for convict, alenko, is used in the New Testament, it means to convict the world in the personal sense. So what that means is, according to Carson, it shows the world this, that their understanding of sin is wrong. Their idea of righteousness is wrong. Their idea of judgment is wrong. It's all wrong, and they're going in the wrong direction. And we need to preach the word. The Holy Spirit works through the Word of God to bring conviction of sin. The Holy Spirit comes to us through the Word. And we need to preach the Word. The Holy Spirit inspired the Word. So the world is deceived and has a false version of sin. What's the world's version of sin? You're the sinner because you don't agree with us, right? You're the sinner because you think people are actually going to hell if they don't repent. You're the sinner because you think Jesus is the only way. You're the sinner because you won't submit to us and our false religion. The Holy Spirit will convict the world of sin. The Holy Spirit was sent by Christ as promised. And he is at work through the gospel to convict the world that its understanding about sin, righteousness, and judgment are false. The world calls things sin, which are not. Let me quote Carson. Quote, the world's judgment is profoundly wrong and morally perverse. The world's judgment is profoundly wrong and morally perverse. Now, that being true, why are we here? Why are all of us here? If we know the Lord and we love Him and we're serving Him, why are we here? Because God wants us to be His witnesses in this lost and sinful world. We need to preach the gospel. If we preach the word with clarity and authority, the Holy Spirit who inspired the word will do His convicting work. And this is the thing that the whole church growth movement got wrong. Got totally wrong. When I was so lost and so angry, so full of darkness, so hating the things of God, if somebody would have given me a religion that said, oh, you can be religious, but you don't have to change anything, it would have done me no good. Not only that, I wouldn't have gone along with it. Because I'd already decided through science that if something's not true, it's not worth believing. But God snatched me out of that world of darkness and showed me the truth. What about you? Do you believe the truth of Jesus Christ? Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for your goodness and your kindness and your mercy. Thank you for caring for us and giving us a place where we can gather to hear the Word of God taught. And I pray for the elders of Gospel of Grace Fellowship that you would always keep them safe, guard their hearts and minds, that they may stand always for the truth, that the word would be taught and nothing else. And Lord, we pray that you give us what we need to do that, the grace and the mercy, the health and the strength, that we can do what you've called us to do. And Lord, we pray that you'd protect, bless, and use every member of this congregation by your grace. Thank you for what you've done for us, dear Lord. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Please stand for the benediction. From Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 20. Now to him who is able to do above and beyond all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Dear ones, God bless you and have a wonderful week.